speaker hired Mike Leach to be a part of his coaching staff at Iowa Wesleyan College in 1989. Over the next decade, including stops at Valdosta State and the University of Kentucky, they would introduce the football world to one of the most explosive offensive schemes ever created, the air raid. Ladies and gentlemen, Coach Hal Mumme.
Well, first I want to express my condolences to Sharon and the whole Leach family. Y'all are truly remarkable people, and we're all heartbroken, as y'all are. For 33 years, Mike Leach taught me that fear and faith are not compatible thought processes, and he constantly reminded me by his actions and by his words and by his deeds of that concept. So today, I thought I would try to help y'all. There's no way we can lessen the hurt, but perhaps we can find some comfort. And stories are always a fun way to do that, as Mike was so adept at. So I thought I would tell you how the whole pirate cottage industry got started. Because it happened in 1991, and Mark Twain's first great book was called Life on the Mississippi, and there was a passage in there that we liked. It said, it went something like this, he always had the hope that if he lived and he was good, that God would permit him to be a pirate. And I think God let Mike do that. But in 1991, we were at Iowa Wesleyan College, and we'd gotten very good, and so good that none of the little schools around the area would play us anymore, so we had to play up a level. And we needed an edge. And we were standing in that little tiny office that there's a famous picture of he and I and another coach in that little basement office freezing. And we looked at each other and we said, road trip. We gotta have a road trip. We need an edge and we need to find it. And so I said, Mike, I want you to find someone in Florida that we can recruit so I have an excuse to go get the money from the president to fly to Florida. So Mike being Mike, of course, found a kicker in Key West. So I went to the president, and I asked him for money to go to Florida, and he gave me about $800, which would only get us to Orlando from Chicago Midway, which if anybody has ever made that trip from Mount Pleasant, Iowa to Chicago Midway, that's 4 hours. And Mike was serially late. And we had to get on this airplane at like 5 a.m, and so I told him, you got to pick me up at like 2 o'clock in the morning. We gotta get there. And of course he was late. And I was so mad at him, I didn't talk to him for 4 hours all the way to the airport. And then we got our tickets and we were going to the gate and he tried to speak to me and I went, not talking to you. If they fire me for missing this flight, then I'm gonna fire you first. So I just wouldn't talk to him. So finally we get our seats on the plane, we get buckled in. They've gone through all the pre-flight deal and we're getting ready to take off. And as only Mike could do, he looks over at me and he deadpans and he says, so apparently you're mad. And I cracked up, bro. I couldn't stay mad at him. I broke up laughing. We had a grand time and we created what is known as Air Raid now came out of that trip. So we're landing in Orlando, and Mike, wanting to make the most out of having to drive 10 hours to Key West to get one player, said, I know these people, they have a spring league down here called the World League of American Football. And it's being coached by this guy named Don Matthews, who would go on to win 6 Grey Cups. And Mike said, I know one of the coaches there. Maybe they'll let us come visit. So we called them, and they were very gracious. We went over there, and we're walking out to practice, and I looked at Coach Matthews, and I said, what's your best drill? And he said, watch bandit drill at the end. That's where we practice our two-minute offense. And so Mike and I were standing there watching it, and we were just – we'd seen two-minute offenses before, but never this well organized. So he it was just so good. And we just looked at each other, and we immediately knew we had found our edge. But we weren't going to do it in 2 minutes. We were going to do it all the time. And so we took it back and put it in. And then we proceeded in the rent car towards Key West. But along the way, we stopped off to visit Dennis Erickson at the University of Miami. And we wanted to know how they threw the ball deep so well all the time, vertical routes. And we waited around for the receiver coach after practice, and he's kind of slipped out. And then we're just kind of standing out in the hallway by the coach's dressing room, too shy to talk to anybody, really. And Dennis came out in his boxer shorts and his T-shirt, and he said, what do you guys need? And he said, we want to know about vertical routes. And he goes, well, come on in. So he took us in the coach's dressing room, showed us how to stack cornerbacks and how to throw vertical routes, and so we added that to the package. And then the next stop was Key Largo, where we signed a tackle. We managed to sign more than one player on this trip. But the important thing about that was his dad, after we signed him, took us deep sea fishing for red snapper. And we did that for a whole day. And then we got back in the car and we proceeded to Key West. Now this is the key part of the pirate story right here. So the first place, we had driven around all these places in a 1984 Ford Taurus, trying to find all these ideas to put into our offense, put into what we were doing. And this was the ultimate trip. We finally made it to Key West, because the whole time we would drive around, we would listen to Jimmy Buffett all the time. It was just, that's all we played. In fact, I tell Jacqueline, my wife, now I kind of miss the 80s and the 90s in terms of music. All I can really tell you about is Jimmy Buffett. And Mike was kind of the same way. But we knew about Captain Tony's. And we knew about Tony Terracino, who had been the mayor of Key West. And he was in his 80s at the time. Had this fabulous, he basically was the pirate. And so we go to Captain Tony's, and we sit on two bar stools at the bar. And we're just kind of looking around at all the paraphernalia and everything, all the history in there. And we stay there for a long time, and it gets to be about 1 o'clock in the morning. Now, I couldn't hang near as good as Mike Leach. I have to go to bed around 1 or 2, or I may pass out. But Mike could, he seemed to get stronger as it went on, you know? So I said, look, Mike, I have to go to bed, but if you want to stay, go ahead. So I went back to the hotel. The next day we get up, we're eating lunch, and he looks at me and he goes, you're going to hate me. I go, why? He goes, because you're going to be so jealous. I said, why? He goes, well, when you left, Captain Tony Terracino came and sat next to me on that bar stool you were on. And then he proceeded to tell me the whole story about how Jimmy Buffett wrote Last Mango in Paris about his life. He said, it was so great. And I know you're jealous now. So we signed the kicker, we went back to Orlando, and we're driving along, and I looked at Mike and I said, you know what, I kind of like Charleston, South Carolina. I think I could get the job at the Citadel. I think it's going to come open. And he looks at me in this deadpan way that only he could do, and he just says, I don't want to play soldier. And I said, what do you mean? He goes, well, schools like that, they just, you know, they play football, they go to school, but they dress up in uniforms, and they play soldier all the time. He said, if I'm going to play something, I'd rather play pirate. And that's where the idea was born, right there. So we took all those ideas back to Wesleyan. We ended up winning 10 games instead of 3 and had a great season and then went to Valdosta State. But flash forward, and I'll finish with this. 20 years later, we're still having this conversation about pirates. It just never finished. And I was coaching at McMurray at the time, and we had a big win. And he called up and he said, "Well, I called you to congratulate you, good win, but that's not really why I called you." And I said, "Why did you call me?" He goes, "Because you're going to be so jealous, you're going to hate me." And I said, "Why am I going to hate you this time?" And he says, "Check your phone, I sent you a picture." So I went over to messages, you know, and pulled it up, and there it was. Mike Leach had his bar stool at Captain Tony's. He was a wonderful friend. To all you Bulldogs out there, I'm so sorry for the loss. But I'm glad we could have this time together to share stories.